Amartya, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I said early on that I was hoping that the Philomela choral music would linger on in our minds. I mean, I can certainly say the same about Amartya's wise and insightful wider annual lecture. Now, we have here some 600 people, and there are, of course, many from Finland, but I would like to make the point that they're joined by people from more than 75 countries across the world who've been attending the WIDER 30th anniversary conference over the past three days. I've been saying three decades so many times that. Now, I'm sure that we're going to have many questions from a wide range of perspectives in this questions and answer session. Now, dear audience, can I please ask you to introduce yourself before you ask your question? And can I please ask you to be brief? We do want to fit in as many of you as possible in this conversation, in this question and answer section. And I don't want to resort to the trick that we sometimes use, namely that the sound goes off. It would be better if we can be brief and concise. But I do realize that sometimes that's not enough. I would also be very keen to hear questions from the younger members of the audience. I said in my opening remarks to the 30th anniversary conference a couple of days ago that it is critically important for our profession to engage with the bigger questions in development. Now, this is particularly so for the younger generation. So I will give priority accordingly, depending on the flow of the conversation. And President Ardesari, please do let me know if at some point you wish to make an intervention. Now, it's a little bit hard to be here and see so many people. So what I'm suggesting that I do is that I sit and can see more or less in the middle. And now I will start here in this side, and then we will move around clockwise. And I will suggest that we take, to begin, three questions, and then we get the conversation going. And I should say that we have allocated, almost an hour and 20 minutes for the conversation, so there will be time to go around the room and hopefully have a good and insightful conversation about some of the wider problems in the world, but also maybe some of the wider solutions and insights. So can I invite comments from this side? Okay, start here.
Hello, my name is Anh, I'm from Vietnam. I'm doing my PhD at University of Gothenburg. I've been reading Professor Sen like since the first day of my economic study. And I have a question for Professor Sen, is that in your book is Identity and Violence, you have mentioned about the importance of culture. And the question is not, does culture matter, but is how culture matters. And I want to ask you and whether you could give more explanation on the role of culture in sustainable development, not in terms of environmental issues, but it's also in terms of social issues, especially in how education could change our perception about our identity in a globalization world. And advice to the young economist like me, because I'm really interested in culture, and I wanted to know your opinion.
There was somebody just behind, yes? The lady there with the glasses, I can see at least.
Thank you. I'm Jenny Kauppila from United Nations Association of Finland, and I'm really pleased to have heard this wonderful lecture. And I would like to ask your opinion, since you mentioned the need for new research agenda and You mentioned sustainable development goals. You mentioned sustainable development, and now we have new sustainable development goals coming. And I was thinking that could there be like a moral issue, like oil drilling in the Arctic, for example, that would be sort of an research agenda issue as well? It has been in the NGO campaigns, but how does it show in the research field? Thank you.
Okay, and then here.
Jim Davies, I'm from the University of Western Ontario in Canada. Professor Sen, in your book on economic inequality, which I think came out in 1976, you put a dedication, I believe, to your children, and you said that you dedicated it to them in the hope that however they decided to measure inequality in the future, there would be less of it. We've seemed to have seen some hopeful signs that on a global level, at least, there is less inequality. I'd be very interested in hearing your comments about that trend and how hopeful you think it is.
This was the first three, I think, Amartya.
I think with that, again,
yeah,
my
better
memory.
Get a bit yeah. Okay.
My memory may be a little better than my metal knees, but. let me go in reverse order. I'm delighted you mentioned that. There was a 73 book on economic inequality, which is a dedicated thing. No matter how you measure it, there would be less. I think it's partly, it expressed what I wanted to, you know, to think about the future of the world, since I do regard inequality to be a major issue and have thought that throughout my life. But partly also, the book also dealt with the fact that particular criteria may differ, and when particular measures of inequality may differ. But quite often, what you're talking about is not sensitive to which measure you use. And that's why I'm saying, no matter how they decide to measure it, there will be less of it. And so the intersection partial ordering, to talk of it in mathematical terms, is a big thing in the book, of which the Lorentz dominance is the oldest kind. So I'm delighted you mentioned that, because that comes up in every way. And today, in some ways, you could say that inequalities have expanded. In other ways, it's gone down. Quite a lot of it going down is due to China, in fact. Sometimes India is included in it, but and to some extent that's true. But the biggest contribution is China, but in per capita income terms. In China's case, there's also been much more inequality reduction because of basic school education being widely shared and basic health care, which actually, for a while after 79 economic reform, they did not. They actually abolished health insurance provided by the state and the communes, and the coverage fell from 100% to 12% between 79 and 80. But they recovered ground. So these things have actually tended now to move together, excepting, I would say, that since I do regard human rights and democratic rights to be important, that there are some issues to be addressed there, particularly in the context of political context in elections, multi-party elections, big thing, if it's a part of inequality that you're looking at, then that's not. So there isn't an intersection on the other, I mean, the intersection does not generate the different measures don't go always in the same direction, but quite a few do. In case of India, I think along with the inequality issue, and it's not so much that inequality has dramatically increased, but I think the persistence of the inequality between people with opportunity of good schools and not having those with not that, is remains strong. If you would hear Indians are producing lots of good people, and it's true, they're running Microsoft, they're running Google, and they until recently Deutsche Bank and so on. And at the same time, a huge number of people don't even get the most basic elementary education. That kind of inequality worried. So it's not just the income inequality, and in this case, no matter how they measure it, hasn't happened. And if you, even the achievement of poverty reduction in income has not been quite matched with poverty reduction in terms of education, healthcare. And it doesn't depend only on public government policy. You require and this is the question, the question about culture at the beginning, you require a politics, a culture, a politics in a national sense, whereby these issues remain important and people pay adequate importance to that, which hasn't happened despite India having a democracy, hasn't happened. And I was very pleased that when Mati quoted from my, kindly quoted from my New York Review piece, saying that democracy in itself doesn't guarantee it, it's an opportunity, you have to use it. So I think inequality in the kind of form in which we talked about in UNU-WIDER 30 years ago, where capabilities began playing a bigger and bigger part in the thinking then, at least in my thinking, it remains very big. So I'm really pleased you brought that, and I think the scorecard is uneven on this across the world. Now, on the subject of the the quality, the moral question, the moral quality, I think that is very important. You know, I'm one of those old-fashioned people who happen to believe in the fact, in what I think is understanding that a lot of our moral failures come from inadequate appreciation of the facts of the case. There's a puzzling remark that Wittgenstein, the great philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, made, I think in a letter in 1918 or so, to someone called Edelman, if I remember right, saying, I sometimes wish I was a better person. That is more intelligent. So I raised my eyebrows. What could Wittgenstein be meaning? More intelligent has nothing to do, or does it, with being morally better. I think the point he was making is that a lot of our moral failures come from not understanding the totality of what is involved. It's like the children find it quite often easy to kill insects in a kind of torturous way by putting salt on it or something. And we find it perfectly fine to enjoy our lobster when it's reddened and though there's a great deal of pain going on there. And the claim was that if you fully understand, you better understand what's happening, you would actually act differently. So I think quite a lot of the moral issues involved in, and NGOs of course play a very big part, in my judgment it's a very central part of democracy, because democracy is not just election, it's also about getting issues raised, discussed, and standing up against other problems. For example, if there's a issue involved, if the Greenpeace gets into difficulty in India today, on ground that somebody wanted to make a point and she was not allowed to go. Well, there NGOs are fighting for a moral quality that the country needs. And so NGOs played a part. But I never took the view that a lot of economists don't worry about it because they're not concerned with people. Their morality does not include how their lives go. I think most people who are on the other side and who are often arguing with me and attacking me too, take a view of what happens in the market economy, which is very far from the reality. And they also take a view that somehow, for example, you could raise your income now and then do your education and healthcare. I think that is an epistemic problem. I don't think it's primarily an ethical problem. And I think a lot of the moral concerns that the questioner was raising not only come through the kind of public engagement in which NGOs may be involved, but also from better appreciation and fuller understanding of the nature of economic development. And that's one of the reasons I keep quoting Adam Smith again and again, because it's a sad fact that some of the things clear to Smith in 1776, not to mention his earlier book, 1759, now 250 years later, don't seem to be clear to people today. The first question from the gentleman from Vietnam, I think it's again a very interesting question about the role of culture. And we spent a lot of time in wider and early days, and I think there's one way of thinking about culture, which is that culture is important. Another way of thinking of culture is a part of life. And what is important is the richness of life, in which culture could play a big part or a negative part. When it plays a part of giving people the opportunity of advancing their thinking, then it's playing a very positive part. Education is part of culture. When, however, it deals with some cultural tradition being continued, or like, say, gender inequality, treating women as in some ways less deserving than men, well, that's culture too. That's all the way. You don't have to go as far as genital mutilation to understand that there is a cultural problem involved in that. And yet culture is a changeable feature. There was a study dealing with the practice of foot binding in China. And it's interesting that there was a time when it became clear that a lot of the individual family members did not want their daughter to undergo foot binding. But that was such a dominant culture that it was very difficult for any individual to stand outside it. This research, I've forgotten his name, he's now at the University of California in San Diego. I'm terrible that one of the oddities is that I teach some mathematical economics, that I never seem to forget a proof, but every name is gone. Someday when I say, who was it who wrote Wealth of Nations in 1776, you can take the liberty of informing me and telling me that it was Adam Smith. So anyway, so this is the guy who did the research on that. And what happened, in fact, is a very interesting history of how it ended. Some people decided that they will not allow their daughter to be foot-bound alone, irrespective of others. And as that number grew, 15-20%, it didn't. By the time it came to 35-40, there was an avalanche. And within 2 or 3 years, it became 100%. So I think it teaches, and that's a cultural feature too. Namely, we live in a society, we depend on each other, and we depend on each other's approval and disapproval. That's a very important thing. This is very important even in the context you were referring to identity and violence, I think, and I do talk about that a bit, and so thanks for that reference. It depends on what part of culture you remember. I mean, for example, terrorism is a very big thing in the world today. Even in the nuclear context, it came up. But terrorism generally is very, a very big issue, and I was very privileged to serve along with Sadako Ogata as co-chair of the human security, the UN Commission for Human Security. And it includes both, of course, poverty, which is insecurity, and hunger and famine, but also the terrorism and violence. And yet, quite a lot of it is culturally related, not in the sense that some people, as Sam Huntington thought, are culturally prone to a certain type of violent approach, but it's a question of focus, what you read. And take the fact that the biggest news at the moment, maybe I'll give two examples, Islamic terrorism, ISIL, Well, it depends on whether you take what is claimed to be a part of their culture about the violent and forcible conversion and so on. And many countries have had that. India has had big attacks at some stage, including temples being destroyed and so on. And yet, it's also the case that we use the word algorithm today, remembering 9th century Arab Muslim mathematician Al-Khwarizmi, from whose name the term comes, from whose book Al-Jabr Muqabila comes the term algebra. Half the world of mathematics at that time, still be related to India, and Arabs get huge credit to Indians, in fact, and came from the Arabs, and they all, the big book begins always with praying to Allah and so on. That doesn't prevent you from doing the highest level of math. Mm-hmm. Now, what is the Islamic heritage? Do you think of the killing of the infidel, or the doing the highest quality math? These are the people who preserved Aristotle and Plato when Europe destroyed it, and they had to be retranslated from Arab. I'll give you an example, some of the cultural contrast. Think of the word sign in trigonometry. Sign, you know, you remember that, your trigonometric notion. Where does it come from? The first use of it was by one of the pioneering trigonometers in India called Aryabhatta. And I feel personally linked, because when the Nobel Museum wanted two objects of mine, I gave them a copy of Aryabhatta's original book, not the original copy, but a reprint of from 401 AD. And also I gave them my bicycle, on which I carried data on gender inequality and boys and girls, and also some food thing. So there's a bicycle and there's Aryabhatta. So Aryabhatta called it, the sign, after explaining the concept, called it Gia Artha. Gia is a diameter, Gia Artha is a radius. And if you remember your trigonometry, you could see why it would be called that. He abbreviated it and often called it Gia. When the Arabs translated it, they translated it as Jiba. Now, Jiba has no meaning in Arabic. But Arabic, like Hebrew, doesn't have any vowels. It's consonants written, and vowels you could imagine. Like Kabir and Akbar are basically the same name, K-B-R. So the later generation of Arab mathematicians, and Aryabhatta was translated 4 times, Brahmagupta was translated 6 times into Arabic, because they were very interested in studying it, and developing it, and spreading it. So then a later generation called it not Jiba, but Jeb. Jeb is a good Arabic word, meaning a bay or a cove. Now, when 1150, Gerardo of Cremona in Italy translated into Latin the word Jeb in his book on mathematics, he translated the cave or bay or jabe as sinus, which is the Latin word for a bay and a cave, cove. And that's where the word sign comes from. So in one word sign, you see 3 different cultures, the Latin-based European culture, the Arabic mathematical culture, the Indian mathematical culture in Sanskrit, happening in that put together. So it's that totality that we have to look at when we are looking at that wider view, if I may use the word wider, of culture, is what we have to look at in order to understand culture, and not the narrow view with which I associate the class of civilizations. So thank you for your question.
Okay. I think we will take the lady over here.
Thank you. My name is Heidi Kaila. I'm from the University of Copenhagen, and I have one question regarding the issue that you already addressed, namely terrorism. So I read on the UNU-WIDER website your text on
this. Your question, I couldn't hear the word.
Yes, so my question is on terrorism.
Terrorism, okay.
Yes.
My favorite subject, yeah.
Yes, exactly. So I read on the UNU-WIDER website your text on this annual lecture, and you highlighted the issue of terrorism and conflict as a challenge for development economics research for the next 3 decades.
Yeah.
So could you please give some advice to young researchers and young economists on how to approach this issue in their research? And I would be interested in hearing your comments, especially regarding data collection and the issue of scarcity of data on this area. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we go all the way to the back?
I love the way Finn has this facial equity.
I'm Prakash Singh from Amherst College. How can public services in health and education be made more efficient in developing countries? In particular, how can market mechanisms such as the role of performance incentives for healthcare workers and school teachers be implemented to improve efficiency? Thank you.
Okay, and there was a gentleman to the very far end, almost towards the wall.
Thank you. Yeah, my name is Petri Minkin. I'm an independent scholar here, based here in Helsinki, Finland. And if I understood correctly, you have been written also on migratory issues. So my question would be now, because we have, during recent months, there's been a growing concern here in Europe and also here in Finland about the recent growth of migration or immigration to Europe. So my question would be, from the point of view of development and development economics, what Europe should do now in relation to this issue? And the other question, because you probably can see some to the future, as we all, to a certain extent. Also from the point of view of development and the development economics, how do you see the prospects of migration, let's say, from Africa and from the Middle East to Europe, let's say, during next 15 years?
Okay, thank you. I seem to hear a very young voice. I just want to say that that's an absolutely definite, sure priority. So if there's a very young voice that wants to come in, then I can guarantee access. Amartya.
Okay. I think, let me begin with the hardest question, namely, what should Europe do? I think it should do several things. And when I say several things it should do, it does not mean that that will solve the problem. That's not the right way of thinking about anything. I have a book called The Idea of Justice, and among the gambles I have on what is basically a Hobbesian approach to justice, thinking in terms of ideal justice, is that that's not the way we proceed. I mean, it's always worth thinking about that, but you need a theory of justice which also can, while recognizing it at the one end, also talks about what steps could be taken right now. It's that duality we need. Now, it applies here too. In some ways, central to that recognition is whether how strong is our human identity. I'm not talking here about border control, I'm not talking about anything, just how strong is our human identity. Now, ultimately, I think human identity being more important than it seems to be in national thinking is a dramatically important thing to cultivate. The it's not the case people don't have it. Otherwise, somebody asked a question about NGOs. It's amazing how much people are ready to sacrifice for the sake of their human identity. I was very privileged for 3 years to serve as president of Oxfam before it became a kind of much more of a complex international structure when things were rather simple many years ago. And I was very struck by the fact how people were risking lives, when we did lose lives at different places in the world, would go to serve causes of people they have not only never met, they barely knew, but they knew about the suffering and the fact that they could make a difference. So that is, in some ways, the kind of thing that human identity can produce. And if you think about the nature of global history, to think of it in terms of, you know, we have generated it ourselves and nobody else, that actually does not really explain why some countries have been so much richer today than they were in the past. In that sense, the part of engineering, of science, of political organization, in which, if you take Europe, a lot of European genius and work has played big part. But it has also, it not only based on that, it also has borrowed the Chinese science and used Indian and Arab mathematics, of which I give an example, Gerardo of Cremona, when he was translating Arab work, he was contributing to the Renaissance and indirectly to the Industrial Revolution. So we have to think about that interdependent world and human identity to be able to place the problem in its proper perspective. And some people, whom I greatly admire, like people who take such huge risks to serve as in NGOs, I mean, really, some of the NGOs are really hard NGOs to work in because of the dangers and the hardship involved. They already may recognize certain things, that a much bigger recognition of that is really quite important. Along with that comes the division between, say, religious. I grew up at a time of religious turmoil. Bengal, where I come from, has had very little communal violence in the past. And no communal party had won an election in Bengal until 1946. It's always been secular parties. Bengal is a Muslim majority area. There are Muslim chief ministers, but they were not for secular parties. Things did go wrong. And then again, Bangladesh has been able to construct a situation where it very had huge features of secularism. The dominant culture is a secular, politically secular, personally religious. Most people, it came remarkably at me when somebody asked me to be a patron of a function in Dhaka called Bengali International, and they were very worried about Islamists and very worried about secularism being under threat. And they came to me and I arranged lunch for them. And of course, these secularists, none of them ate lunch because this happened to be in the Ramadan period. So the interesting thing is that there is, of course, no conflict in your personal religious belief and still being totally committed to secularism. And you see that in Bangladesh often, because it's 92% Muslim. And many functions, in fact, standard functions with the Prime Minister, you will hear a 90 seconds of 3 minutes of Quran, followed by 3 minutes of Bhagavad Gita, 3 minutes of Bible, and 3 minutes of the Buddhist Tripitaka. Now, for 8% of the population to get 3/4 of the time is a lot of secularism indeed. And I think it is possible to construct it. Look, Bangladesh was lucky. It had a great leader in the form of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, and who could actually make that as a way of seeing yourself should end so happen that in the history of Bengal, 46 was the first victory of the Communal Party. But by 54, Bengal is very different. Bangladesh is a very different identity they're playing with, namely the identity of being a Bengali. And the Bhasha Andolan language movement became a dominant factor. Now that in some context could be also a divisive one. Depends on the context. Europe fought the First World War with the division between Germans and British and the French. It was massively important. Religion was not. And yet now people would think of that division to be almost nothing. Whereas the division between being Christian or Muslim is enormous. There was a time when a man called Gautam Buddha, who established Buddhism, was going around why, and his disciple like Ashoka, while on one side you should argue for their perspective, but all the other side tolerate everyone. And yet in Burma, or now called Myanmar officially, you have found the same Buddhists, people belonging to Buddhist monasteries, being in the forefront of killing Muslims in Burma. So I think it really depends on how important we make this our human identity to be, and recognize the multiplicity of identities. It allows us also to fight one identity battle with another, like Bangladeshi did, use the language against the division between Hindus and Muslims. And similarly, you can think of it in many other contexts. So I think this is the way to look at it. And coming back to the European question, that would be also ultimately the solution to the problem. I'll say two things, and I didn't say the second thing, but I wanted to get this point through. I think right now, it is a question, I think Germany, with which I was German policy, and I was somewhat critical, was critical of the Finnish policy too, on the subject of austerity. And I don't think that was ultimately, it was not a very intelligent policy. In fact, any policy that, in order to cure Greek's problem, reduces the economy by nearly 30%, cannot be, they must have to have a different economic theory in their mind. There's something that has gone deeply wrong in that thinking. But then the Germans have actually, even though they have changed, stopped that now, absorbed enormously more than any other country did in this respect, and really lived up to some of the leadership role that you might play. I think the solution now will have to be of this kind, understanding where the tensions are. I don't think the main tensions are coming right now from Africa. And they are now, the main tensions are coming from terrorism hit Middle East. And that's why terrorism is such an important thing today to stop it. I think most of the refugees are coming from places like Syria and so on. And I think, so the question, whole world has interest in cultivating global peace. Europe has too, not just because of its refugee problem, but also because of its refugee problem. So there are many things that Europe can do right now to make the problem a little easier and reduce injustice in the world rather than going for ideal justice. But if we are inspired by ideal justice, the idea of human identity has to play a very major part in that. I'm sorry, that was a long answer to the question.
Did I see? Yeah, so we will take one more here. The lady sitting, yeah, and then I'll move over to the back half of this side.
Riham Riz from Egypt, assistant professor at the British University in Egypt. My question belongs to the MENA region.
I just in Egypt?
In Egypt, yeah.
Yeah, where?
In Cairo, but in the
border, you know. Itself, yeah. Okay.
So my question is, I want to know your opinion about what's going on the MENA region. You know, as we all know that actually the as a result of the uprising and the we do have a lot of instability in the region. Not only with
I'm missing some of it because
okay. Not only
can
with
you hold it? Yes, yeah, close.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, my questions regarding belong to the MENA region. We all know that we are facing instability. We're not only going to the security issues and the conflicts, but also the economic problems becomes worse after the uprising. We have, for example, high rate of unemployment among the graduates, inequality rate, and blah, blah, blah. I'd like to know what do you think the development strategy that should be developed, it should be followed by these countries in order to recover from what they are facing. And actually, I would like to know also, in addition to the achieving democracy and its principles and following as a start for achieving development it could be the initial step that should be followed by these countries, or as they call for the government authorities in these countries, they are calling that we are going to achieve economic growth and after that we will make it inclusive. Thank you.
Okay, so okay, there's a gentleman at the very far end, and then there's a lady just above.
My name is George, University of Ghana. Professor Sen, I like your work on the rational fools.
He's over here.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Maybe okay. I'm too dark, sorry.
University of Ghana.
Yes. I like your work on the rational fools.
Thank you.
What I want to know are two issues. One is, how far has the rational fool changed since 1977? And with the advent of the networked world, how is networking influencing behavior and development into the future? And again, I would want to know, those rational fools, how well do they influence policy with the advent of social movements that are occurring in various parts of the world? And what would be the implications for development, especially poverty and inequality in Africa? Thank you.
Okay, the lady just behind but up a bit.
Thank you. My name is Tru Shedvin. I am from SIDA, the Swedish. Here?
Fed SIDA or Swedish SIDA?
Swedish SIDA.
Swedish SIDA.
My name is Tru Shedvin. I think we are all grateful to you for widening our perspective on poverty to a multidimensional perspective on poverty. So we all now talk about poverty as resources, but also as power, choice, opportunities, and related to that, security. But then when we assess and measure the developments of poverty over a period of time, we kind of struggle in keeping that multidimensional perspective, and we fall kind of back into monetary measurements of poverty. What is your advice to us in improving the way that we assess and measure poverty so that we keep all the dimensions, also when we look at the developments over a period of time? Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Please, go ahead, Amartya. I was just trying to signal to the left-hand side over here that I will come back.
Yeah, Amartya. Actually, let me follow the questions in the... Actually, I'm going to leave the question from Ghana to the last, because I want to say something about Alex Kwapong in that context. So I begin... I begin with the question from the lady from Egypt. I think this is a very important question. I personally happen to think that democracy and development are not only important in themselves, but also democracy is a part of development that one has to recognize. Development is not only not just increase in GDP, is not only, nor is it just expansion of human quality of life or life expectancy, but also a society in which human beings are free to express their view, to work for their view, to try to persuade others. So public dialogue is very important, public reasoning is very important, and I think that's very central to development, both because it enriches human life and also because that's the way we can get policies corrected. Like if we are going to change the kind of single focus anti-global warming, but not worry about nuclear danger, we have to get that into the dialogue. So democracy is very central for that. Now, you pointed out, and you're absolutely right to do that, lots of people are tempted to say, why don't we have first economic growth and then we'll build democracy? I think there are many problems with that. First is that it's not clear that not having democracy will necessarily have economic growth. I mean, when people say we don't like democracy, they're opting for a basket in which they, you may be China or you may be North Korea or Somalia or somewhere, you know, and there are real problems, and they are dealing with North Koreans are very fine human beings and not any different from South Koreans. And yet, why is the country in the mess and why is there no development? So I think it depends. And if you look at even China, China had the worst, largest famine in recorded history, in which, when I originally wrote about it also in New York Review, suggesting 17 million deaths, I was told that it's impossible, people couldn't have got away with that. But by the time I published a more research paper on that, the estimate then was 30 million. Now the Chinese government themselves talk about 42 million. And this happened in China, which in many ways was progressing much faster than India. It didn't happen in India. That doesn't mean that there's nothing to learn. Everything is negated by the Chinese famine. Another way of looking at it, the lower mortality in China compared with India really means that every 6 or 7 years, more Indians died than died in the Chinese famine. So you have to take these lessons rather than saying which one we do. China had a big problem in 79, as I've already mentioned, when they suddenly one morning abolished state universal health insurance, and one stroke went from a Canada-type system to a US-type system of healthcare, and that wasn't an improvement. It wasn't an improvement in Chinese condition, it's not an improvement in US conditions. And I think there were many other things you can similarly point out. So could China have achieved the same rate of growth if they abolished democracy? No reason whatsoever. People used to say that about India also, that India, because of having democracy, India didn't have any growth. But when India was growing at 7.5-8% a year, it was still a democracy. So much so that the government regenerated, it lost office shortly after. There couldn't be a bigger test of democracy than that. So I think that contradiction is an imagined contradiction. It doesn't exist. We have to, and it's similarly like the identity, the fact that you may have a strong universal human identity doesn't take away the pride that you might have in your Finnish identity. The fact that you can enjoy the music that we heard, you can enjoy the wonderful experiences that Finnish society produces. Nor do you have to have live in a place without a sauna. I've discovered that my place, the room I was in my hotel, may or may not count as five star in every respect, but it does have two saunas in within my premises. I've never had a sauna, but since I thought I might suffocate myself in heat and not be able to come, and I haven't yet tried it. So I think we assume contradictions exist when none do. So I'm delighted you raised the question. Now, the CEDA question that was raised, I think here I want to say something. Measurement is a much easier thing than people tend to make it. Now, I wear many hats, and I get bored with the subject I teach, so I vary. This year I'm teaching a course in mathematical economics and a course in the medical and public health school. 2 years ago, I taught a course in postgraduate mathematics along with a mathematical colleague of mine, Barry Mazer. And because that used to be a lot of my interest very early in my life. Now, one of the problems is measurement. And the way we learned mathematics at that time, there was a great book, there was no human being, called Bourbaki, a French author, but not an author really, a cluster of people who wrote under the name of Bourbaki. And the way if you read general topology or set theory, it begins, where is measurement? Measurement begins with ranking. Now, rankings are not necessarily complete. You might be able to say certain things. You might be able to say, look, I think everything considered, I would prefer live in, in one country rather than another, live in Britain rather than another country which is much poorer. But that doesn't mean you should be necessarily be able to compare living in Britain as opposed to France, as opposed to Finland, as opposed to the USA. You may not be able to say that answer. That doesn't reduce the fact that it's a ranking, it's a partial ranking. What Bourbaki called pre-ordering. When you have a pre-ordering and when it becomes complete, then you get a complete ordering. When that complete ordering has certain structure, you can attach numbers to it. Not all orderings are numerically representable. When you have some more structure, those numbers have certain characteristics. So if you double one, you have to double the other. It becomes like weights and heights. And there are various intermediate degrees, which we also, in that class, went through. But the beginning of it is ranking, partial ranking. Now, when somebody says, for example, that we need to pay more attention to culture, yes, but it's not quantifiable, and therefore any quantitative thing would leave that out. Why is it not quantifiable? What's the problem? Why do we need to pay attention to culture? Does that make the society worse off? Yes. Well, there you got a partial ordering going anyway. You just said that society which pays no attention to culture is worse than a society which does pay attention to culture. That's the beginning of your partial ordering. So many of these measures has to be done in terms of the degree of measurement that would be appropriate to the variable. I'm very old-fashioned. Not only do I quote Adam Smith in 1776, but I even quote Aristotle, who said in Politics, in one of his books called Politics, each subject, has to have that degree of precision and exactness in its measurement and expression as the variable of that subject demand. And I think many of the things that we have to measure, they are not going to come out in quantitative numbers. They will come out as rankings of various kinds. And there's an enormous opportunity of doing that, and that's not, people say it's not quantification. That's absurd, of course, because if something is better than another, you know that the other cannot be given a higher number than the first. There is a numerical restriction already there. I even actually wrote a paper many years ago on exactly that subject. of the called representation of partial order, numerical representation of partial order. So I think we have to think about the substance. Ultimately, it's going to be a conversation. And the conversation has to be about content. The content may be for some cases like literacy, maybe some numbers would be usable. That's what Millennium Development Goals did. But the Millennium Declaration, which claimed Millennium Development before Millennium Development Goal, had other objectives too. Had things about democracy and human rights. And democracy, you may not be able to attach a number, but you might be able to say that, just as I said, that North Korea is, from a democratic point of view, is not only worse than Japan, but also worse than China. Now, that is already a statement you're making. So I think when the second round comes, we have to place much more to real material for debate, conversation, and argument, rather than quantification. And arguments are about sentences. They are not numbers. You say something. The argument don't go like saying 136, no 129, but I wanted 142. I think that would be an insane conversation. So conversations use numbers, but they also use rankings. So that's the direction in which I would go. Now I have to go to Ghana. So Alex Kwopong, Alex, you come from the University of Ghana. I promised to go to the University of Ghana for 6 months when Alex visited Delhi when I first met him. And he was a great talker, and he talked me into agreeing to go to Ghana for 6 months. But then, of course, he himself quit and went off to UNU. And then I didn't go to Ghana because no one renewed that offer. I'm not offering to go again now at the age of 81, but that time would have been a good time. But he was not only a good talker. Alex was there. When I arrived in Cambridge, he had a huge reputation. And this is interesting since he's so important for WIDER's early days. He had a real reputation as a classicist, which was his subject. And very often when we would discuss things about Maastricht versus Helsinki, bits of Greek and Latin would flow into our conversation. He was also a great dancer. He had a huge reputation for excellent ballroom dancing. He was a few years ahead of me. But one occasion, I actually danced with I could never dance. But someone was trying to teach me and who claimed that he had danced with Alex Kwopong, the greatest dancer. Well, he failed in a project in my case. But after that, he did give a diagnosis. He said, you know, you'd never be able to dance very well because you are too hesitant. You're trying to figure out. You have to lead. That's what Alex Kwopong did. And you would never be able to be a success in life because you don't know how to lead. Now, I think of her often, actually, and think very nostalgically about Alex Kwopong leading us. But the big thing that I learned from him was, of course, and I'm taking this opportunity of the Ghanaian question to talk about that, and it does relate to the question about, you know, you said about rationality and rational fools and so on, about taking the multidimensional aspect of rationality. When I asked him, what did you learn? I mean, you're from Ghana, and you're spending your time doing Greek and Latin, and so it would be like me. I spend a lot of my time doing Sanskrit, but I have to ask always the question, what do I benefit from that? And he said he got a perspective which he couldn't have got without that classical education. It's the breadth. Now, when people complain about rational fools, it's not rationality I was complaining about. And I was a little shocked to see, and my friend Joe Stiglitz must have been in a great rush, that the messages that are put on the board, Joe is put against rationality in economics. Now, I don't think he is. He is against rational fools in economics. He wants rationality. He wants, like all of you do, want to have reasoning, argument, do the right thing. And the rational fool characteristic is a guy who cannot tell difference between questions, which have already come up in this discussion, that it is in my interest, it is a better thing to do, this will be the right thing to do, I will do it, I will vote for it. These are completely different propositions. Only a rational fool could confuse that. It's like saying, as a Finnish gentleman, Finnish person, it's, I cannot attach any importance to world identity, human identity, because I have a Finnish identity already. Yeah, that's a distinct identity, but you could value them all. That's the issue, and I think I'm delighted that you like rational fools, because that's one of the papers I spend a lot of time trying to convince the world about, and I would need your help. But also, because it makes me think about some of the really nostalgic relations I was thinking of, especially when I heard about his death recently, about what I learned from Alex Korpong's learning of Greek and Latin and the perspective that he did. And I think the quotation from Aristotle, which I gave, he would have given it, of course, in original Greek. That is one of the many different ways in which we can learn from widening our education, one of the objectives that Korpong had for WIDER right from the beginning.
I can't help add that the present chair of the WIDER board is the present vice chancellor of the University of Ghana, and I can tell you that he both knows how to lead and to dance. So, yeah, here, Lishi.
Yeah, I'm Li Shi from Beijing Normal University, China.
The where?
China.
China, yeah.
Yeah, Beijing Normal University. So Professor Sen just mentioned the global income inequality has been declined, largely due to the fast economic growth in China. So that means my question is that, you see, when the China, the move from lower middle income country to the middle income countries, that really, you see, contributing to the, you see, equalizing impact on the global income inequality. But we suppose the China continued having fast economic growth. So nowadays, you see, GDP per capita in China is quite close to the world average. So when the China continued fast growth, that become high income growth, yeah, high income countries, that will have a disequalized impact on the global income inequality. You see, that is where, increase, you see, inequality in the world. So my question is that, if the country is so important for the change in the global income inequality, the whether, you see, that make the measure, you see, measuring the global income inequality become less important? So we suppose a country, you say, from the low-income country to middle-income country where decrease global inequality, then when it become high-income country, then decreasing, increasing inequality. That is my question.
Okay.
Thank you.
There was a gentleman here.
Is it on? Professor Sen, namaskar. My name is Sepul Barua. I work in a Helsinki-based consultancy called Indifor in the area of forest and environmental economics. I proudly admit to you that the very reason I started to combine economics with my forestry study is because of your work and your winning the Nobel Prize in economics in 1998. I have two issues that I would like to know your thought and opinion on. The first thing is that...
Be brief, okay.
Yes, sure. In past 10 to 20 years, there have a lot have been talked about and written about microcredit and its role in poverty reduction. I wanted to know what is your thought on that. I mean, microcredit, its role in poverty reduction, social inequality. And other thing you have touched upon already a little bit is the role of secularism or secular politics in promoting poverty reduction, sustainable development, and social justice. Thank you very much.
Okay. There's a lady here in the front. Okay.
Thank you. Professor Sen, I, of course, like everybody here...
I know who you are, but you have to tell others.
Okay. Yeah. This morning, I came to breakfast at the restaurant and I saw Professor Sen sitting there. So I went to him and I gave him a big hug because I wanted to thank him for all the things he gave us. And he was very sweet. So, you know, thank you very much. I have two questions. And I appreciate all your work, but especially the part that does with gender equality and the role of women in development. The first question is, it is now becoming more and more... Then I'm sorry, I'm not going to use your question, my question. Okay, it seems like all the nice things we do to push through development, you know, for humanity are great. But if we look at, for example, the impact of education and health, we now have people who live longer. And that's a great thing, especially if you are in rich countries and you are working and you have a nice retirement plan. But if we look at poor countries, now we have the children who are educated leaving and going to the cities or to other countries. And the older ones are left home without anybody taking care of them, especially if they're really low income. This is more true for women because on average women outlive men. And so I was wondering if you think that there is two levels. One is if we need an international effort to address this, the people aging longer, but especially women without anybody to contribute to their livelihood. And second, whether within state this should be taken on by what is becoming now more fashionable again, the role of a developmental state. As you know, in recent years, we have been contributing the higher growth in many emerging countries to the active role of a developmental state. Is that something that we should be looking at also? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. These are actually excellent questions also. So I'm beginning with the last, since I was... I think the problem that about educated people leaving family and going abroad, it's a big serious issue. And it's something that has to be addressed in some way rather than shutting off education, I think. So that's the problem there. And I always think that recognizing a problem is halfway to solving it. And I think if that is the problem that's emerging, then you have to see how you can, it may have something to do with the content of education, it may have to do something to do with the opportunities of job being more available in the area, and some of the migration you refer to are even international. It has something to do also with the rural areas being more enjoyable and livable and so on. And you know, in some ways, it's not a, these are not absurd challenges. These are all mutable factors. They can be changed. I think even compared with when I was a child and growing up in a village area, I think the opportunities in India had major failures in many things, schooling among them. But certainly, it always had richness in music, but cinema, has become almost extensive. It's not surprising that India makes more films than any other country in the world. And there you go, there's, you know, the, if you take the density of films, cinema houses across, it's pretty dense. This is a topological concept, namely, you're arbitrarily close to a cinema anywhere. And I think that, does it make a difference? It does make a difference. But I think the job is the big thing. And job is a neglected thing in thinking in the world. I think job is a neglected thing in the European central bank policies. It was a neglected thing in what emerged as the European Commission's policies. It emerged also as the neglected thing about how to deal with Greece. Greece is right now in a state which is, we don't quite know what the election would produce, but this is the only time in the history of the world when lenders have lent money to a country insisting on conditions if, which, if followed, would make it impossible for them to pay back that money. What is needed here is not morality. What is needed here is a bit of intelligence on that, I think. I'm sorry to have to say that. Intelligent thinking. I mean, there are some of the biggest mistakes are made by very clever people. And I think this is one of the... So I think we have to rethink on the job situation and how important it is, how central it is to all the thinking that we have across the world. So thank you very much for raising that. And I want to demand another breakfast, maybe tomorrow. The question of Mr. Bora on the environmental, no, I think on the microcredit subject, I think microcredit is undoubtedly one of the major benefits for anywhere in the world. I think that one has to make a distinction between microcredit being very important and microcredit being a solution to a problem. You can't solve all problems in the world with microcredit. You can solve one problem, namely that of getting credit. And that is very important. It doesn't solve education, doesn't solve employment, doesn't provide health care, and so on. And I know that there have been debates, particularly in Bangladesh, on that. I think one has, and I think each side has tended to, you know, in some ways oversimplify the problem. But I think the microcredit work that was done by Grameen Bank, and of course BRAC has been doing that too. I mean, these in their context are doing important things. Whether the claims are made on favor of them was more than what could be justified, that's a different kind of issue, and we don't have to deal with that issue. I think I have to go on because I think Finn can't tell me easily, they keep your answer short, but that's what he's intending to, I know, I can see him. So of forestry, I would say, very good to combine. Just one word, that world's oldest university in Nalanda started in 420 AD, which we are now reviving, and I was chancellor of it until 3 months ago. One of these schools we are trying to build up is the environmental school, and that started already from last year. And that being done in cooperation with the Yale University Forestry Department. So there is a real reach there. I wish we could talk more, but we can't right now. Now on the China question, that's really also very exciting. I think the important thing is that China becoming a middle-income country is a celebration for everyone in the world, not just for China. Because one of the things that it has done, and there the Nordic model comes in and the East Asian model comes in, Mao Zedong may have started schools and hospitals not thinking that this would help capitalism. But there is no question that the market economy in China could not have expanded as fast as it did in the post-reform period, if it's not riding already on successes on education, fairly widespread, in sharp contrast with, say, India or South Asia generally. So I think that was a very big achievement, not just raising the quality of life, but making the market economy possible. It's the thing that Japan first started in 1868 with the Meiji Restoration, then South Korea, Taiwan, and then all of China, combining a market economy along with, not just market economy, the state too, for reason that, as I quoted Smith having made clear. But that combination worked very well. That combination does not mean that the Chinese are going to necessarily feel themselves detached from the rest of the world, even if they become high-income country. China was one of the greatest achievers in the world when it did a lot of things. Take the printing. The first printed book in the world, 868 AD, had an international feature which comes in on the human identity. I could have given an example, like in the sign there. What was the first printed book? It was a Chinese translation of an Indian Sanskrit book. It was the Diamond Sutra, which in Sanskrit, Bhadra Sedika Prajna Paramita Sutra, I read in school. I should mention not in Chinese, but it was translated 6 times, first time in 401 or 405 AD, I think. And it was published in 868 for the spread of, it's a Buddhist book, for the spread of universal enlightenment. What did the first printed book in the world say in the dedication? It said, printed in reverent memory of my parents and for universal free distribution in the world. The very first printed book. Now, I don't think China was thinking of itself as only, this is neither a Buddhist sectarianism nor a Chinese sectarianism. The reference is not to China, the reference is to the whole world. And it's being printed in that. So I think our ability to combine our global perspective, our human identity, along with success, and with a great success in the world. I mean, there were little attempts in India which wasn't successful. Korea, China, Japan very closely came. They were all Buddhist engineers. Players, they were competing with each other. Chinese won the battle narrowly. But in none of those cases was the objective of global education very far from their mind, because they repeated again and again. When I was studying in the history of printing, I was struck by the fact how global it was. And of course, it had a huge impact on expanding education in China itself. And so, ultimately, I think in what we are calling East Asia model, and I think something like that it would apply to the Nordic model as well. So I'm sorry, I will be shut off now. So I would thank you for the question.
I know that there are lots of more questions, but I have gotten very strong signals up from the back. And even if I don't have some sort of snail sitting here giving me signals, I've been told that it is about time, but I think that President Artisari, you have a question.
Actually, I don't have
a... You need a mic.
I think it would be better if you had an observation.
Yeah, I know.
Actually, I thought that I would manage without this. But I ask your permission, Finn, to speak as an honorary citizen of Namibia. I was inspired because of the question of gender equality. Because my wife and I are both honorary citizens of Namibia, and I was involved with their independence. And we attended now in March the 25th anniversary of Namibia. And I want to tell Namibia. You about the Namibia, country. Yeah. What I found is that, first of all, there's a free primary education in the country. They are now going to make the secondary education free. That's what I call trying to run towards an equality in the country. They have also decided that half of the post of members of parliament have to be women. They are still short, perhaps two or three. I'm not surprised that the president that retired, Lucas Pohamba, got the Mo Ibrahim Prize, annual prize, which will be given to him in November 22nd, we are going to be in Accra, where he will receive the prize. But I wanted to mention this because I said to the new president, Hage Geingob, that I will invite him to Finland to come and give few lectures here during his stay, and try to explain to Finns how to actually implement the gender equality in Finland. He said to me that, Marty, don't be in a hurry with your invitation. Because first of all, I have to get economic growth going better and fight the poverty in my country. I just want to mention this, and I would advise everyone to look for Mo Ibrahim Good Governance report that comes out basically every autumn, where all the countries in Africa, it varies from some around 52 recently has been covered. And they have been put into our order. In that, Namibia has been six among the 52 now for many, many years. But I want to give this sort of good example, that there are good examples, and look at the Mo Ibrahim report, because it gives a first-class picture of what is happening in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, President.
Finn was asking me, what should I say in response? It's very easy, actually, and it's even, sometimes somebody wants to say something and the question is, how can you make it into a question? Now, a question in this case, do you agree? And I'm very easy to answer, namely, yes! And I take this opportunity of saying how much I have for my period when I was here, and of course I also happen to know his wife and his son who worked on capability a long time ago, have had connection that and always valued that connection very much, and I'm particularly touched, necessary that you're here today and very grateful. And could I suggest that we give a hand to
On that note, can I ask my four colleagues to join Professor Sen?
Am I supposed to do something? Or?
No, absolutely. I mean, if you wish a hug, you can certainly.
Oh yeah, indeed. That sounds like a very good idea. Okay, thank you. So, hug. Okay. Okay. Good. So I can stand here, I guess.
Yeah. I wish to express...
I hope I have not.
...our deepest appreciation to Professor Sen for being our guest in Helsinki. This has been a truly wonderful way of celebrating 30 years of wider achievement. Now, you will also note that four wider research fellows have joined Professor Sen. They include Dr. Carla Canelis from Ecuador, Dr. Nadia Vidrago from Burkina Faso, Dr. Smriti Sharma from India, and Dr. Surab Singhal from India. I and WIDER as a whole want to signal as strongly as we can the importance of the younger generation driving the next decades of much-needed research for action in development in the spirit of Professor Sen. Professor Sen, you wrote the very first wider working paper on food, economics and entitlement, published as wider working paper number 1 in February 1986. Now this was followed by now more than 5,000 wider publications over 30 years, including the best ever selling volume on hunger and public action, authored together with Chandres, which I have right here next to me. Amartya, as a small token of our deep appreciation, we've kept for you not a book from thousands of years ago, but the very last copy of the original print run of Working Paper 1. Nadia. Nadia, can I ask you to present on behalf of WIDER, WIDER's first working paper to Professor Sen? And I hasten to add, we do have reprints of the working paper for everybody in the audience to take before to leaving tonight. It's at the exit as you go out. Professor Sen, can I ask you to join the front row?
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
At the very beginning of this afternoon, I promised that the Philomelic Choir would return. So, can I ask you to remain in your seats and enjoy the music with Professor Sen's WIDER annual lecture in your mind, after which you're all invited to the reception outside. Thank you very much, Professor Sen.